So what I will do is I will cut down some of the examples, but we have to just come into the Indian society. We are still in history and some conceptual terms. So very briefly I would say that the intervention of imperialism in the history of Indian society basically leads to an arrested development. This arrested development does not allow the inherent forces which would have arisen as it did in the Western world for its own bourgeois democratic revolution in its own form. The intervention by monopoly capital and the physical colonization of this country leads to a situation where the dynamics change, where there is an alliance which is formed between imperialism while introducing capital labor relations. It also has to collude with feudal relations in its social structure, in its extra economic forms. And this reality is a separate topic altogether, but it basically says that your rights therefore work on a duality. There are two major key contradictions, instead of the one principal contradiction. Instead of capital labor relations, it becomes one side moribund capital, monopolistic capital, coexisting simultaneously with decadent feudal practice and culture. Now in this, when you locate certain rights, you have a duality of the right operating one in the codified form and the other in the practice form. And this dimension is a fact which is where in India to interpret human democratic and civil liberties becomes a task, and it is only through political economy from the perspective of the relation between sections and classes which within this mode of social production that you can locate and define the from the perspective. So in essence, the British basically introduced a lot of industry from the railways, etc., a lot of bureaucracy, a lot of education for its own rule, and it establishes rules, regulations and sets, leaving its own constitution back home with the Queen. It establishes the judiciary and the executive to rule in India. Now this means that a lot of codified law comes in and gets established and stated. It is used by British imperialism as it defines best for its own perpetuation and its control and hold within the Indian society which it has colonized. So ideologically, politically, militarily, economically, socially and culturally, it aligns with a lot of feudal forces and with the culture, and it rules the society in duality. The revenue system continues in many ways. The British also need it. It breaks into three systems. So I will skip all this and basically say that the inherent dichotomy of the alliance between imperialism and feudalism, the dichotomy of semi-feudal, semi-colonial society, that obfuscates interpretation and practice of rights versus duties. Not only during imperial rule, but in many cases, much more in the post-colonial period. How do we interpret rights here? And therefore we will take a few. So the colonial state, while introducing codified legal structures, did not have any answer for its implementation, given the social cultural reality of feudal practices and socially sanctioned legal relations. There is a concept which when we read and we started understanding in years gone by, from preface to our contribution to the critique of political economy, while trying to understand the Indian society, and that key formulation was that social relations having a social sanction are legal relations. That becomes the reality of ground rule operations in Indian society vis-a-vis the codified law which is established from above. And these two can be in sharp contradiction, and one has to fall silent while the other practice has to continue. That is the collusion between imperialism and feudalism, and that is the place where you can have the derailment of a pure capital labor relationship into something which is extra economic, which we call refeudalization. Having said that, I would like to go into certain examples here. Would you like to take this or should I continue? Right? So we'll take an example. So having established a few points, I'll quickly summarize. State, civil society and political economy as one construct. Right, the right to choose and change because you are not born into it, vis-a-vis duty, idealist and materialist perspectives to view these, specific social context and a class perspective, which gives a context to understanding human rights, civil rights and democratic rights, which are actually intertwined, and you cannot easily distinguish these, but you can see which dimension is reflecting what. So let's take an example of child labor. It is codified that child labor is illegal. Now it is incumbent either on the parents or on the civil society in its systemic functioning, definitely on the state. What is your answer to the child who needs to live? His fundamental right, his human right to life, nourishment, who is going to answer for that child? Just as a backdrop, 40% of India's population, almost 500 million, live below the poverty line. Now, who is going to give that right to the child that you cannot work? It is a very good orientation to say a child must get education, absolutely right. There is right to education. A child must be given all freedom to express itself in its childhood. Absolutely right, it must be given, afforded that. But the point is, it must be afforded and given that. If it does not get, then where does the child reside? Do you want a welfare state? Possibly a welfare state is the answer. Somebody has to answer for this. There can be an alternative perspective. There's a society takes responsibility and says that the child at different ages can perform different jobs under very defined conditions and control, under supervision, while doing those jobs, because that person who earns as a child labor is possibly also supporting her or his family, apart from himself or herself. And that is the right to life, the fundamental right. At the same time, you can say that if you categorize children of ages and the type of jobs they can do, this is one argument, possibly, to locate child labor, and say that you also provide at the same time the education required for the child. You also provide the child the nourishment it wants, the books it needs, the curriculum it wants, the co-curricular, extracurricular activities, and you can well define it as children working but also learning. Imagine this entire construct being given to as part of corporate social responsibility, that you work on this and you please give. It can well be formulated. So when we look at child labor, at one side there is codification and it is illegal. On the other side, nobody has an answer for the human right of the child to live and survive. In fact, a small footnote on education in this, we are saying the child, just to explain this whole concept of civil rights and democratic rights and human rights, a child has the need to be educated. So providing schools is one dimension of saying that in civil terms we have provided school, the child can go to school. The child has certain needs in that school, in its functioning, whether it be in terms of this infrastructure, facilities, availability of teachers, books, including the demand that if the curriculum is appropriate the way it is being delivered. These rights, if the child and his parents or people collectively demand, becomes a democratic right. The fact that the child wants to change, or people behind it want to change, and it is denied, becomes a human right violation. Or the fact that the child, when growing up, demands a job and is not able to get one, it becomes a human right violation because it is the right to life. It's a derived right. But that's as a part and a part. Let's take another example. I'm skipping out some of the other examples of displacement. Tribals who have the right to utilize nature, land, sea, water, animals, when you are displacing them by bringing in forest laws, ecological laws, development project laws, and you are not being able to reintegrate them in their own social construct, that is a very gross violation of human rights of tribals. unless they are participating and wanting and part of the process of change, it is a gross violation of human rights of theirs. Untouchability. It's a very interesting thing. It comes from the whole factor of caste. There is an entire religious practice. There is an entire factor of caste. There is an entire factor of untouchability, which basically means the lack of access to resources. So you are denied the access to water, for example, the right to, the ability to drink for survival, the ability to use to produce, either way. This becomes a gross violation of people, whereas untouchability is declared as illegal, codified law. So you have codified law on one side and you have the practice the other side, which basically says that how do you want to view this right vis-a-vis codified law, which is not being able to exercise it in practice. There is no mechanism to implement it. So this is basically based on the formulation that social relations with a social sanction are legal relations vis-a-vis codified rights. There's a very interesting dimension which R.S. Rao also gives, that the working class can also demand rights to be given the necessary knowledge, education on processes of production, technology, methodologies, managerial systems, whereby it can become knowledgeable about the entire social production process. Now the system says you have the freedom to go and learn on your own. You can educate yourself, you can take technical classes, you can take engineering classes, you can take management classes, and you can begin. Now the right here lies in the fact that the ability to access those facilities does not exist for the worker. The ability to access those facilities, if it does not exist, then that right becomes hollow. Then of course you can also practice. That is the meaning of bourgeois codified law versus the inherent right of worker to say, I have the right to acquire this productive knowledge, this productive force within me, but my conditions don't give me access to these resources. So the fine line of rights resides here, which really can be seen only through the eyes of political economy and from the perspective of class relations. Similarly, caste system. So this is one of omission. There is one of commission, which is the caste system. The caste system poses a hurdle to the free thought process of human beings. The upper caste inherently declares that lower castes don't and have the ability to think. It is denial of productive forces, denial of human rights. These are human rights violations. Scheduled castes in their respective social milieu have as much as workers in their factory surroundings are pushed to a non-human status when free thinking and knowledge accrual are denied. Attack on right to life by being denied access to productive forces available in society, physical or by way of knowledge, as relevant to the individual and collective thereof, is a violation of human rights.